Canada. Canada is a country in North America. It has 10 provinces and 3 territories. So what if each of these 13 entities became their own independent state and country? Well, first of all, Canada would no longer exist, therefore no longer occupying the slot of the second largest country in the world by landmass, a role that would now be filled by China. In terms of size, Nunavut would be the biggest of the new countries, followed by Quebec, the Northwest Territories, British Columbia, Ontario, and Alberta. New Brunswick, Nova Scotia, and Prince Edward Island would be the 3 smallest. The Canadian people would also probably no longer have the British monarch, now the Queen, as their head of state, and would likely each become an independent republic, each with their own president, maybe even keeping some of their current leaders, but in different roles. Although I guess some could just maintain the Queen while being fully independent, just like Canada is now. When it comes to the names, I doubt any change would happen. The only two I could see changing their name would be British Columbia and Prince Edward Island if these new states were republics which fully cut sovereignty ties with the UK. Then the region of North America, which apparently also includes Central America as a sub-region, I didn't know that, would go from having 23 countries to 35. The ones that we usually associate with North America itself, just Canada, the US, and Mexico, would go from having 3 countries to 15. The US would cease to only have 2 land borders, one to the north with Canada and one to the south with Mexico. It would now have 9 land borders in its northern limits. However, we could put forward the hypotheses of one or more of these new countries wanting to join the US as an American state. It wouldn't make much sense from my point of view to leave one union for the other, but this is all hypothetical, so it's something we can also consider. Before we get into a breakdown of how each of these new countries would fare, let's understand how they exist now. Like I mentioned, they are 13, 10 provinces and 3 territories. The 10 provinces are Ontario, Quebec, Nova Scotia, New Brunswick, Manitoba, British Columbia, Prince Edward Island, Saskatchewan, Alberta, and Newfoundland and Labrador. The 3 territories are Yukon, Nunavut, and the Northwest Territories. So, what are the differences between a province and a territory? The major difference between them is that provinces receive their power and authority from the Canadian Constitution Act of 1867, and territorial governments have powers delegated to them by the Parliament of Canada. So, from my understanding, the rules of how they rule are fixed for provinces, but subject to change for territories, according to what Parliament decides. And essentially, provinces have full autonomy to decide what they do, while territories do not. Now, back to the point of this video. What if each of these 13 regions became independent? To my knowledge, there is no intense rivalry between any of them, nor are there any common claims for territory, as far as I know. Plus, Canadians seem like a peaceful people as a whole, so there's really no reason to think that these 13 states would not coexist peacefully with each other, since there would be no reason for war. They would actually likely all join up in some sort of Canadian alliance to ensure mutual protection, and probably all join NATO right away as well. Each of the new countries would therefore fly their flags side by side in peace and harmony. Speaking of flags, we would lose what for me is one of the best flags in the world, the red maple leaf. Although maybe some variants would exist with each state's new independent flag. Provinces and territories in Canada already have their own flags, and while a few of them could maintain what they have now, some would probably change them. By the way, even without independence, some really should. Ontario's flag still has the Union Jack. I mean, come on, if Canada as a whole removed it, so should they. Plus, in the case of independent, they really should. A new flag could be green with the 3 golden leaves in the middle. Quebec already has a cool flag that depicts their local identity, so they could keep that, and the same happens with Nova Scotia, which has an awesome inverted Scottish flag with the Scottish coat of arms in the center. New Brunswick has a cool flag, but which should, in my opinion, be simplified a little, especially in this way too far stretched lion at the top, which I would remove. Now, I'm out of room here, so let me move to another screen. Manitoba would also need a change, perhaps in green, red, and white, with the golden bison in the center, kind of similar to the US state flag of Wyoming. British Columbia's flag is essentially two flags stitched together for some reason, so I just recommend removing the top half and they'd be good for independence. And now I'm out of room again, so I'll show the next ones a little smaller. Prince Edward Island's flag is just this very confusing set of trees and random lines with a lion. The trees are so odd that I don't even know how I'd go about changing it. Saskatchewan's flag is simple and great, it's to the point, it's representative. I don't think a change would be needed there. The same goes for Alberta, although I'd use a lighter blue and restyle the coat of arms. Come on guys, this isn't a US state. And Newfoundland and Labrador is also pretty good, different to what we usually expect from a flag, so I would keep that one. Then we have the territories flags, which are also pretty good, far better than a lot of the provinces, in my opinion. The Northwest Territories have a good one, Yukon as well, although a little too similar, and Nunavut has a fantastic flag. So after checking out how the flags could change, and how these new countries would therefore represent themselves, we can take a look at the new borders. Only the southern countries would border the US. British Columbia, Alberta, Saskatchewan, Manitoba, Ontario, Quebec, and New Brunswick. Oh, and Yukon would border Alaska as well. A big issue would come up for a few of these new countries, which would be the fact that they have no sea border, therefore making trade by sea more difficult. Although I think only Alberta and Saskatchewan would face that problem, plus it's likely that some type of agreement regarding the free movement of people and goods between these new countries would be made to facilitate circulation. We could also have the cases of new countries merging together. Some are so small and with so little population, as we'll see in a second, that maybe full-on independence wouldn't be viable, and so they would have to join up. Prince Edward Island is a good example of that. A very small place which could join New Brunswick or Nova Scotia, or who knows, maybe these three could come together. Or Newfoundland could join Quebec, and perhaps the three territories which, despite being large in landmass, are very sparsely populated, could join and form a single new nation. We can also look at this differently. Instead of each region becoming its own state, they could separate according to their cultural background, half the country following the British heritage and another part the French, or maybe even adding a third one for the native population of Canada. Now let's take a look at a few important statistics that could give us an idea of how each of these new countries would do. First, one of the most important, population. This data is from the 2016 census. Canada has around 35 million people, but the way in which these are distributed is very, very radical and extremely concentrated in certain areas. Take a look at this map. Half the population of Canada, 50%, lives below this line, in this tiny sliver of territory. Let's see how the people are distributed per state. Ontario is the most populous, with around 13.5 million, 38% of Canada. Quebec follows with 8 million, British Columbia 4.6, and Alberta with 4. This is the top populational tier, decent sizes that would make up for decently populated countries. Then comes the second tier, which is small, but still rather acceptable and manageable. These are Manitoba, Saskatchewan, Nova Scotia, and New Brunswick. Then we have Newfoundland with 500,000, and Prince Edward at 140,000, which is actually a lot when you consider the room that they have. And then comes the third tier, which are the territories. Giant masses of land with very few people. Northwest only has 41,000, and the other two only 35,000 each. These are tremendously low population density areas, not even reaching 0.1 people per square kilometer. Population numbers are important because they give us an idea of how many people the country would need to support and finance, how many people would be working, how big the economy is in terms of production and consumption, and how many people there are to pay taxes or serve in the army, for instance. So from this, we can conclude that the first year would be fine, the second I think would be okay, but the three territories do not do very well in terms of population. Of course, this could be solved by having government programs that incentivize births or creating great living conditions that attract migrants from other countries, or just accept you have large portions of your territory that belong to nature alone, either because they are in hospital, which is the case here, or because they want to protect the environment, which is also extremely important. From an economic point of view, we can also see how each of these would do. This data is from 2018. Canada has a GDP of around 1.8 trillion, being the 16th largest economy in the world. Ontario has the biggest share of this at 710 billion. If they were to maintain, they would equate the GDP of Vietnam and would therefore become only the world's 33rd largest economy, with a GDP per capita of around 50,000, matching Bahrain's. And this would be the best result, Ontario matching Vietnam, out of all these new countries. So none of them would become economic powerhouses upon independence, as is the case with other countries' hypothetical examples, like California. Quebec has a lot less, but is at number 2 with 363 billion. Matching Qatar in GDP and South Korea in per capita. So while they aren't giant economies, the per capita numbers are decent and match some of the most developed countries in the world, showing us that wealth distribution might be good and quality of life in each state would probably be decent if maintained during independence. Alberta matches Sri Lanka in GDP and Kuwait in per capita. Others have not so great results, matching some less prosperous African nations, but even in those, the per capita numbers are much better. This shows us that they have very little population, and so the numbers per person remain high, with Saskatchewan matching the Netherlands, Manitoba matching Japan, Newfoundland matching Germany, and Yukon matching the US. But again, all this could change as these new countries' economies would certainly suffer and diminish in case of independence. They would also likely need a new currency, a new one for each new country. Maybe they could keep the name dollar and just be Ontarian dollar or Quebecian dollar instead of Canadian. These would probably devalue a lot with local independence, which would lower Canadians' power of purchase throughout the world. Or they could come up with new names for each state's currency, or maybe even form an economic union like the EU's Eurozone and keep a common currency, although this kind of defeats the purpose of this video. When it comes to unemployment, this shows us how the economy is doing and how many jobs there are. British Columbia has the best results as of the end of 2018, with only 4.4 unemployment, followed by Quebec and Ontario. The worst are Newfoundland and Labrador, with a large 12.2 unemployment rate, followed by Prince Edward Island and New Brunswick. Like I mentioned, there's also the issue of language, but I think the only exception to all of these being mainly English-speaking nations would be Quebec, which would keep French as the main language. Although maybe some could keep Canada's policy of having both English and French as the official languages, as significant percentages in each area speak both. Newfoundland is the most English, with a 97-3 proportion versus French, and Quebec is the most French, with a 79-9 proportion. There are also indigenous languages, about 25-30 of them. While very few people speak them, the most spoken is Cree, at around 100,000 speakers, they do have some importance when you put them all together. For instance, in Nunavut, 67% of the people speak neither English nor French as their main language, most speaking Inuit languages. The Northwest Territories have 20% native language speakers, as is the case with 6 other provinces. It seems the 3 territories are the most native, so it could be an opportunity for them to unite into a single country with a definite home for the Canadian native people to have their own free nation. But none of this seems very viable in most cases, and it's certainly not realistic or likely to happen. The reality is there would basically be no benefit to any of them in becoming independent, and the few benefits that a few could have would not be sufficient to compensate the immense loss that would follow, and the extreme difficulties that most of them would have surviving as an independent nation on their own. Plus, there doesn't even seem to be a reason to do so, since independence movements inside Canada are very few and very small, with the big exception of Quebec, which has sought independence a couple times and has significant movements to do so. So, despite the fact it would be extremely interesting to witness, my recommendation and opinion is that Canada should stay together as it is. And that was a quick overview at the hypothetical idea of each Canadian province and territory becoming its own independent state and country, or other possible ways in which Canada could break itself up into new sovereign nations. Thanks so much for watching the video. If you enjoyed, subscribe and leave a comment below, letting me know whether or not you would like to see this happen, if you think it's possible, plus other countries where it could happen. And if you have any other suggestions for new videos, leave them down below as well. I will see you next time for more general knowledge.